Cole, as I said, is the CMO of Smokey Bones. She comes to Smokey Bones from the advertising side many years at Zimmerman. Please welcome Cole Robillard.
I'm a mover, so I'm going to try this hand mic. Hopefully, I don't fall. Before we get started, I know we've got kind of a mixed crowd in here, so I wanted to just ask, does everyone know what a virtual restaurant is? Show of hands. All right. A couple people don't. Does everybody know what a ghost kitchen is? Can anybody tell me the difference? You can also be your own ghost kitchen. We have one of those. But yes, very, very good. So for the purpose of today, we're really going to focus on the virtual restaurant, which is an exploding category. By a lot of estimates, there's over 100,000 virtual restaurants in existence right now. And that's just what can be counted. I saw a Technomic study came out yesterday. It said 46% of independent restaurant operators are now doing VR. So this is a category that is here to stay. It's exploding. But nobody knows about it. Only 9% of people have knowingly ordered from a virtual restaurant. That number goes up to about 16% when we're talking about millennials, because they're a little cooler than we are. But it's definitely a category that's here to stay. We're seeing a lot more growth and development in this. It's obviously a lot of opportunity here. So, again, for those of you I haven't met, I'm Cole Robillard. I am the CMO of Smokey Bones. We are a protein-powered concept with 62 restaurants in 16 states on the eastern half of the U.S. And you're probably asking, why is a casual dining CMO up here talking about virtual restaurants? Well, because we have two virtual restaurants that are in the QSR fast casual space. We launched those a couple of years back. We also have one ghost kitchen. At Smokey Bones Meat is what we do. We do it very well, and we're very proud about it. You might need to borrow your video. But that is something that we've woven throughout everything that we do, both in the physical restaurant as well as in the virtual. So I'm going to go back in time a little bit. We started out on the third-party apps about 2017. And we were just really kind of starting to get into the groove with those. We really hadn't maximized the partnerships. Uber Eats came to us with an idea, and they said that they had done some analytics, and they were looking at our core trade areas. And there were a couple of our core items that people were searching for a lot, but the demand was exceeding the supply. There weren't enough restaurants that were actually providing those items. So there were two items in particular that were very good at Smokey Bones, smoked wings, or regular wings, and burgers. But when people were using the third-party apps, they were not looking at Smokey Bones for that. We're known for barbecue. So, in partnership with Uber Eats, we ended up building out these two virtual restaurants that were focused on delivering just those two items specifically. And that was a way to really kind of focus on those items and get those out a little bit more, build out underutilized day parts. So, we also wanted to be really cognizant of the fact that we were building these brands in a keyword-driven environment. We're building this in a third-party situation. So we made sure that we put the names of the food items in the names of the brand. So we have WingX and Burger Experience. Those were born out of that. Again, QSR-style brands that were produced out of each of our 62 restaurant kitchens, available for delivery and takeout only. So the Wing Experience capitalizes on a core item that we have at Smokey Bones. We are very well known for our wings. They are available in three different preparations. We've got traditional smoked, which is kind of our signature. We have an in-house smoker, so Smokey Bones, and boneless. And the differentiator is really that our wings are jumbo, and we made them available in 50 flavors. So that was kind of a category-leading decision there, because at that time, in that moment, this is 2019 when we launched these brands, customization, personalization, very important to our guests. Especially, this is a brand that both of these brands are really targeting more of the millennial audience. And the second brand is the Burger Experience. And this one was really focused on chef-inspired burgers, premium ingredients, a searing spice, premium buns, but not chef-driven prices. They're very approachable. Prices started at $6, and they range from $6 to $8 for both of these brands, we made them their own brands. They're very individual. They have their own packaging. They're not tied to Smokey Bones. We never hid the fact that they were Smokey Bones brands, and in the media, all the press releases, it all very, very specifically tied to Smokey Bones. But we wanted to be known for our specific mastery of these items. The other thing that was really important was we wanted to make sure that these were really easy to operationalize. These are items that were already made in our kitchen that our staff was already familiar with making. So all we were doing was just letting them shine on their own. So a little timeline here. So again, we launched in the fall of 2019 as a pilot with Uber Eats only. It was specific to them. We had some initial success, and we started rolling out a little bit more broadly. We were actually in a very good position when COVID hit, fortunately. I think we had a little bit of a head start on the competition, thankfully, because we were able to really build out the off-premise part of our business pretty quickly, launching system-wide very early on in 2020. In the summer of 2020, we were able to roll out the brands at both of our across all of our restaurants. We also quickly realized that if you're operating only on the third-party app, that the numbers start to get a little tricky. When you factor in commissions, when you factor in the promos, the discounts that you're giving to your guests, the margins started to look a little scary. So, of course, we wanted to make sure that people could get to us directly. We did what everyone is doing, building out our own website. We have independent e-commerce sites for both of the VRs, virtual restaurants. And we want to make sure that our guests are able to get to us directly if they want, and also that new people are able to discover us. We started building out the brands eventually outside of just the third-party apps as well. The wonderful thing about the third-party apps that we didn't know right in the beginning is that their users are incredibly committed and incredibly loyal. These apps are so sticky. It is incredibly difficult to get someone to switch from being a loyal third-party user to switching over to a brand side. So a lot of the restaurants are trying to figure out what the right way to manage this is, and we've seen a lot of people adding premiums onto their pricing on third-party, 10, 20, 30%. Consumers are kind of used to this at this point, but there's a threshold. There's a certain point where you hit where people are saying, okay, we're not going to do that anymore. And you're seeing a lot of the news media is covering right now just that the discrepancy between restaurant pricing and third-party pricing is causing an issue. And also everyone's trying to incentivize guests to come over to their own channels. And certainly, you know, that's an opportunity as well. But we really just kind of found that the best thing with the third parties is really just to try to be as aggressive as we can and try to use them for the acquisition channel and appreciate it. At the same time, we've been building out the brands on our own. So we've really tried to create cultural relevance for each of these virtual restaurants. Both of these brands, we don't have huge budgets for them. They're virtual restaurants. We hope that they would become a big part of the business. They really are starting to become a large part of our off-premise business. But the things that we've tried to do to really make them more relevant, we've leveraged a lot of our supplier partners that we use inside Smokey Bones. This is kind of our version of the Doritos play. We've partnered with a lot of our spirit partners. We do a lot of flavored wing sauces with some of the spirit partners, which gives us a little bit of cultural relevance or connectivity. Our media placements, we're doing everything is digital. We are doing some BuzzFeed quizzes, things that try to build up the brand awareness. We've found that actually helps with third-party conversion. So when we're doing brand awareness on here, it helps validate on the third party so that when people see the brands, even if they're not familiar with them, they've kind of got a little bit baseline of awareness. And then we've also just kind of tapped into cultural holidays and anything that we can that gives us a reason to jump into conversations. With burger experience in particular, we built this brand at a moment where nostalgia was kind of coming into play. Certainly in the last, you know, 2 years, it's become a lot more relevant. And so the marketing that we've done around BurgerX, the brand itself already had kind of a sort of retro vibe to it. But the marketing that we've done in the last year has really leaned into that. So I'm just going to show a quick 15-second video. especially on the wing experience. So the wing experience has gotten a lot of recognition over the last year or so. A lot of awards. We just actually got Fast Casual's Top 100 Movers and Shakers. So this is a brand we see a ton of potential in. It's getting a ton of traction. Burger experience is doing very well as well. The challenge is the burger category is incredibly competitive, especially in the online ordering space. And so that is a place where brand recognition does come into play a lot more. But WingX has seen tremendous growth and tremendous recognition. And so both of the virtual restaurants have really been adding to our off-premise growth. You'll see that the black line is our total off-premise revenue. You see that split about the summer of 2020. And the purple line on the bottom is our virtual restaurants. So they have added a significant amount of business to the off-premise segment, and we're going to continue to focus on growing that out. So, key learnings. The most important thing is do what you do and do it well. Don't try to step outside, especially not for the first VRs when you're launching. You need to be able to operationalize this. In addition to this being a keyword-driven environment, it's also a ratings-driven environment. So if you don't have good ratings, you don't have good brand recognition, nobody's going to order from you. So make sure that the kitchen, the team can operationalize and can execute it. Use your resources. Make sure that you're able to capitalize on staff that you already have in restaurants, that you're not bringing in a bunch of new SKUs. You're not changing the way that people have to work within the four walls. And it really helps if you do that. It really helps with the labor cost. Utilize underutilized days and day parts. If you have a business that is all dinner business, think of a VR that you can do that is going to drive traffic during the lunch day parts. Search is everything in this world, so make sure that you're able that the keywords are within the name or that it is easily searchable. Even Mr. Beast put burger in the name of his VR. It just helps with discovery. And then the third party is, we've really just embraced our third-party partners. We are so grateful to have them because it is an audience that we wouldn't have. It is top line that we wouldn't have otherwise. And we really appreciate the access to those guests, and we found that it's completely incremental to what we're doing with the rest of the business. So. And I think questions are later, or if we have time. Okay.
Time to do it now. Questions for Cole.
Fully company owned. We're owned by Sun Capital.
Okay. That changes my answer to my question.
Yes, a little easier to do. I was just curious, you might have said this. Do you still, Melissa Lee with Firehouse Subs. Do you still keep Smokey Bones on all the third-party delivery sites? And if so, how do you kind of manage, competing against your own other virtual restaurants? We've just really found they're different guests. Like I said before, the reason that we built the two virtual brands was because people weren't typically coming to Smokey Bones on the app for wings and for burgers as much as they were for our core barbecue items. Smokey Bones does very well on third-party apps as well, and we've definitely kept it on there. The levers we've been playing with is what are the right promotions? How do we make ourselves as attractive as possible on the third-party apps while still trying to, maintain profitability? There's a lot of levers you can play with on the third-party apps as well. Both, DoorDash and Uber Eats are our strongest partners on there. They're both integrated into our POS. They're both doing sponsored listings. Uber Eats is doing stories. There's a lot of things that you can do to kind of raise your brand awareness in addition to just discounting and promotions. So it's just about playing with the levers. We do a lot of testing, try to see what works, but your question was about Smokey Bones. We don't see them necessarily competing with each other so much as just being experts in different categories.
So the virtual restaurant, that sounds like a great concept, and you guys have basically put together a blueprint, right, for some success with that. Is there thoughts of other virtual restaurants coming soon, and what can you share about that?
Yes and no. Yeah, we have loved the virtual dining space. We've had a lot of success with it. We've kind of learned what's working, what's not. We have other brands in development on the horizon, and that's as much as I will say.
You mentioned an interesting dynamic between sort of overall brand advertising pushing interest in the delivery app. Since you have limited visibility into the data on the delivery app, I'm curious how you're actually measuring that impact, and are you starting to sort of design for it and buy media against it?
Yeah, we've been looking at brand posts, you know, just kind of tracking trends leading into when we launch campaigns, and then what the trend is throughout and afterwards, just keeping up. But yeah, I mean, our spend levels on the VRs are not very high, so we are able to see when we do a little bit of brand spending where the lift is on the other, on the third parties as well as on our own channels as well.
Are you getting any insight? I know you mentioned the difference in performance between the wings product and the burger product. Is that mainly a function of category, or are there other things that you're going to have to do with the hamburger product differently to sort of get it to perform at a higher level?
I believe it's mostly a function of category. Our ratings on both brands are fairly similar, so it just seems to be more of a category challenge, just that people are looking for brands that they're more well versed on or that they have some acquaintance with.
Are you engaging social media and do you have an influencer base? Because it seems like this is the sort of thing that would be perfect for segueing in for using influencer network to help generate interest and visibility.
Yeah, that was actually how we initially launched the brand. We weren't doing paid media around it. We just started engaging food blogger influencers and really in our key markets and tapping into them and getting them to do sort of the advocating on our behalf. We had a lot of success with that early on.
Yeah. That would seem like a natural channel. But from influencers to especially the delivery apps, it would be a common audience. Yeah. Cole Robillard, thank you so much.